Welcome back to Murder with Friends. Today we're talking about Andrei Chikatilo with my friend Daron Dean. And where we're picking up, Andrei Chikatilo has committed his first murder in 1978, but by 1981, he really descends into becoming a serial killer. Mm-hmm. And like we said in part one, if you haven't seen that, go ahead and watch that. He will kill upwards of 52, 53 women. He's confessed to 56. So we can't get into every single victim, but I think that we should talk a little bit about the victimology, how he tracked down these victims, and what was the importance of the transportation system and living near trains during this time.
Mm-hmm. He could pick up basically anybody who was traveling, transients, anybody who was kind of hanging around. I think he would generally pick people who were younger, who kind of seemed like they were alone by themselves. So it was a perfect place for him to pick off people, basically.
Yeah, and another part of his MO was befriending his victims. Mm-hmm. So that's how he got away with, I think, so much, is because his demeanor and how he carried himself. Again, he was a teacher, and he was an older gentleman, and he had glasses. He seemed very mild-mannered, and so if you were to see him approaching a young runaway, or again, it was really hard to track down where everyone was during this time, you wouldn't really be alarmed. There wasn't anything very sinister about his appearance.
Yeah, and I don't think that the victims were alarmed either. I mean, all of them walked off with him at some point.
Right.
So they felt safe with him.
With the promise of some sort of a treat.
Yeah.
Or the promise of some sort of a cool gadget that he had access to that wasn't available in Soviet Russia. Mm-hmm. They were younger. Mm-hmm. When I say that he didn't discriminate against age, I think that probably below like 25 and down.
Yeah, I think there was only one woman who was older than that. And the rest were pretty much teenagers and young kids.
Right.
Yeah.
And most of them were women, but he did, in fact, kill young boys as well. And that is very strange to me, because when we talked about his early sexual deviance, it was exclusively towards young girls. Mm-hmm. So the switch to young boys indicates to me that this was his taste for murder. And he realized that his sexual gratification came more from the act of killing and stabbing to overcompensate for his impotence than the sexual attraction to a specific body type.
Yeah, definitely.
And that's the descent. That's when you become a monster in my mind.
Totally.
Because you're attracted to killing. You're not attracted to the victims. Mm-hmm. It becomes less about the victims. But another part about the train and the transportation element to his story is that he was able to move away from his crime scene without there being, you know, much to do about it.
Right.
It was very normal for people to take the trains to commute to and from work. It's very normal for him to have train tickets and for him to, you know, have that as sort of an alibi to show his wife, you know, where he had been, even though she knew. She is sort of alluded that she has known that something was up, but I guess didn't really care. Hmm. I don't know. How would you not care?
Yeah, I mean, for anybody, I'm sure it would be hard to believe that the person you're married to is a serial killer.
And also, most of Soviet Russia was unaware that there was a serial killer about.
Yeah,
they just
exactly.
knew that kids were disappearing, that mm-hmm. transients, that runaways, that people that were, you know, going to school or that were just on figuring their way out, trying to find their way to Moscow or more opportunity, they were just disappearing. And that wasn't very odd, and I guess they didn't know that they should be on the lookout for a serial killer.
Yeah, I think the media at that time didn't want to portray anything that was going bad in Russia.
I think it was less of a want and more of a, like, I think it was less of a choice. I think that because it was a state-controlled media at that time, I don't think they were given an option, should we run this story, should we not?
Yeah.
It just wasn't being reported and investigated in the capacity that it should have been. Mm. I also think we should touch a little bit on the desecration of the bodies.
Yeah.
Briefly. Stop eating. So a number of times he did eat sex organs, and he would remove body parts like a nose or a tongue. He would slash out their eyes, something that I have learned from Criminal Minds, so probably not the most reputable source, but I know from Elliot Reed, the detective on Criminal Minds, that if you slash out the eyes, that it is an indication that you don't want the victim to look at you anymore, that it is sort of a shame. But also I know from actual research that there is sort of Russian folklore. They believe that the victim's last sight is imprinted on the eyes after death.
Yeah.
So when he's slashing the eyes, perhaps it had less to do with remorse like Criminal Minds told me, and a little bit more to do with trying to get away with the crime.
Didn't want
that imprint on the eyes.
Yeah, and I think he probably didn't want to feel like somebody remembered him killing them either. I think it's also more for him too.
So let's talk a little bit about state-controlled media and what that meant for this case and how it was underreported or how misinformation was allowed to spread. What was the biggest sort of illegitimate story that you heard about that was being spread during the Andrei Chikatilo era?
Right. Well, I mean, not only was it just not really being covered at all, but there was a conspiracy among the community that it was werewolves who were killing all these kids. And media wouldn't say yes or no, so they kind of just let it be. They wouldn't say it's a serial killer. They kind of just let people have their own opinions on it.
Well, for 2 years, it took 2 years for Soviet Russian media to report that there was a killer on the loose. And so that there was one independent killer acting alone, and it wasn't just a series of, you know, of random disappearances.
Right, yeah.
So that is really bold.
Yeah.
And like you said, people did suspect that it could have been werewolves. And also, you pointed this out, I think, in part one, that the interrogation methods at the time led to a lot of false confessions from people who were not involved at the crimes, that were confessing to crimes they didn't commit that were then attributed to Andrei Chikatilo because they wanted the interrogation to end.
Exactly. Yeah.
It was really messy, Daron.
It was bad.
And it makes it worse because by 1984, 15 people had died. So he becomes a serial killer in 1981. 3 years, 15 people die. And it's hard not to say that a lot of those deaths could have been avoided had the Soviet media and police work not been more aggressive and transparent.
Yeah, I mean, I think even just running a story saying, you know, there's kids that are being abducted from train stations, I think even that alone probably would have caused people to be more aware of their surroundings and what they're doing. But again, it was just the time.
Yeah, and I think that it's great for us to talk about it. I would encourage you guys to check out this movie called Citizen X. You can find it on YouTube. I don't know if it's legally there on YouTube, but you can find it there on YouTube. Just don't say that I sent you. And they do a really interesting depiction of Andrei Chikatilo, who was arrested at a train station acting suspiciously. And let's take a look at that clip.
Please stand, citizen.
Chikatilo.
May I have your bag?
Citizen Chikatilo, you're under arrest.
So, yeah. Andrei Chikatilo was arrested in a train station for suspicious behavior, and in his bag they did find a knife and rope, but he was only in jail for 3 months, and then when he got out, the killing continued, and we're going to tell you all about it when we come back.